don't hang on. When nothing lasts forever but the earth and sky, when it slips away, and all your money won't another minute buy. Dust in the wind, all we are is dust in the wind.
All we are is dust in the wind.
Dust in the
only after the last tree has been cut, the last stream has been poisoned, and the last fish has been caught, will man realize he cannot eat money. Is 2012 the beginning of the end, or the end of the beginning? Impossible to tell from that statement, isn't it? All things are cyclical. Isn't the end of one thing always the beginning of another? Now, a lot of what you're going to hear will appear new, although I'm not telling you anything you don't already know, just some things maybe you haven't remembered yet. So during this presentation, I'm going to ask you, please don't believe a word I'm saying. But I'm also asking you, don't believe anything anyone else has ever told you either, including this. You see, even if not one word of this is true, it still may be the greatest science fiction fairy tale ever written, which of course begins once upon a time. Now, never believe stories which start once upon a time. Sorry, always believe stories that start once upon a time there was a princess. Once upon a long, long time ago, in a galaxy not far away from where you are right now, our story begins over 5,000 years ago, 3114 BC, before Christ, in a little country then called Tikal, Mexico, now known as Guatemala, where some Mayans, some fellow human beings, indigenous to Central America, left a message which they felt important enough to carve in stone for future generations. Well, at the same time, they had to know the greater propensity would be that they would never believe them. And nobody believed Noah, right? And as evidence, they knew what they were talking about. Along with their messages for people 5,000 years in the future, with their Hallmark card, they also included this calendar, suitable for framing. A small side note, this is the Aztec stone, a 24-ton adaptation of the Mayan calendar, which was unearthed in Mexico in the 1700s. And it's the world's longest calendar. From the beginning of written history in 3000 BC for 5,125.36 years. When you see a number like this or something related to this Mayan calendar long count cycle, I want you to hear that sound in your head. The start date, the second recorded event in human history, is the start date of the Mayan calendar, August 11, 3114 BC. Fast forward 5,125.36 years. I'm sure most of you know that this longest calendar ends in 2033 days from now, December 12th, 1221, 12, winter solstice. Now, what
baffles scientists to this day is it's not only the world's longest calendar, it's also a map, a star chart, which precisely charts the motion of every celestial body in the galaxy for 5,125.36 years. Cha-ching! Right down to the precession of the equinoxes, an almost 26,000-year cycle, as Earth wobbles 23.5 degrees on her axis while she is in her elliptical orbit, almost 26,000 years. Now, the Mayan long count calendar of 5,125.36 years is based on the precession of the equinoxes. How many long count calendars fit in a precession? How many 5,000-year cycles fit in a 25,000-year cycle? Did you say about five? Or exactly five? Five Mayan cycles. The last one started in 23,000 BC. And to the Mayans, this great cycle, almost 26,000 years, was like one day. And the first 5,000 would start at 6 in the morning. The first 5,000 years would be morning, midday, afternoon, nighttime, and, of course, then late night or pre-dawn. The Mayans knew this. The universe is setting the countdown. A rare solar eclipse alignment will happen between the Earth, the Sun, and our central Sun, Alcyon. In the Pleiades constellation, takes five Mayan cycles to rotate around our central Sun. Our central Sun also rotates around the center of the Milky Way galaxy, the galactic Sun of the Milky Way galaxy, Sirius. But for now, we better find the brightest star in the Pleiadian system and find out our central Sun. Who knew we had a central Sun? This isn't taught yet in schools. Now, to find the brightest star in the Pleiadian system, look for Orion's Belt, those three stars in a row, Orion's Belt, hang a right. There you have the Pleiades. On the other side, Sirius, the dog star. The Pleiadian system, which is way over here, would be better known to stargazers as the Seven Sisters, or to ancient customs, the brother with seven sisters-in-law. Here's Alcyon, our central Sun, which our solar system rotates around every 25,860 years. Well, you know it's exactly five Mayan cycles long of 25,627. There's our solar system going around Alcyon, orbits every 25,627. Now, this would be considered one day, one galactic day. Our solar system in relation to our Sun, if you're in New York and you go to the other side and then you come back again to where you started, that's one day, isn't it? So the Mayans called this one galactic day of 25,627 years as our Sun, with us in tow, orbited Alcyon. Now, a 26,000-year day, you could divide that into 13,000 years of day, followed by 13,000 years of night, couldn't you? That would be all fine and dandy. Anyone want to guess which one we're coming out of right now, which one humanity's coming out of right now? Waking or sleeping? Sleeping. Henceforth, the term waking up. Consciousness is waking up. Now, that would be fine, except for this white band in the middle. Now, the Mayans knew this as a time of no time. In this big giant clock, and for a little while, twice a cycle at 12 and noon, our solar system would go through this band, which would be 22,000 years of day, with 11,000 years of night in between. This photon belt. Professor Paul Otto Hess defined it as an energy ring of incredible size, 760,000 billion miles wide, and intense electromagnetic radiation, and due to intersect our Earth any day now. An astrophysicist, Alexei Dmitriev, says that both Voyager 1 and Voyager 2 satellites reveal that our sun, as well as our entire solar system, is now moving into this some interstellar energy cloud, thereby verifying what we've known for hundreds or thousands of years, that every so often, humanity goes through a couple thousand years, an age of enlightenment. Voyager 1 and 2 have been out in space for 25 years since 1987, taking the picture of what it looks like in front as we're rotating through the galaxy. And they found this interstellar cloud, this photon belt, which goes up and down compared to our elliptical orbit. It's perpendicular to our orbit. Alcyon in the center, our solar system around the outside would intersect this donut at 6 o'clock and then again at 12 o'clock. And we're about to come up to 6 o'clock in the morning, brand new day. We're about to be waking up. How on earth did the Mayans know this? See, they had 2,000 years, which I'm going to say is an astrological age of 2160, 2150, or half a Mayan cycle. They said that in that time, Kinikahau, that's our sun, Kinikahau receives a spark from his older brother in the center and shines very brightly. This, of course, clearly pointing to our central sun, Alcyon, or perhaps even Sirius, the great central sun of the Milky Way galaxy, or both. Now let's take a look. Here we have instant photon belt, and as you see, it goes perpendicular to our orbit. When asked how long it would take our sun to pass through this interstellar energy cloud, Alexei Dmitriev replied, "I don't know, but if I had to guess, I'd say somewhere between 2,000 to 3,000 years." Cha-ching. Verifying. Now, people, everybody wants proof, right? Everybody wants proof. Well, pretty soon they'll have all the proof they need. Unfortunately, it'll be a day too late. So the Pleiadian system, our central sun, Alcyon. Who knew we had a central sun named Alcyon? Okay, outorbits our greater central sun of the Milky Way galaxy, which completes its 225 million year orbit around the Milky Way center on this year. So whatever's happening is very special. Sirius, the dog star, 23 times brighter than the pole star. 225 million years to go around the center of the Milky Way galaxy, Sirius, with Alcyon in tow and us and our solar system following along. Oh, totally. Oh, I'm totally serious. Let's pull that back to what that looks like from outside. Our sun, 1 million light years away, is, it's just cosmic dust. Does not become the brightest star until 1 light year, our sun. This is a 225 million year journey. Earth orbits Alcyone 25,627 years with us in tow. And our sun orbits Alcyone with us in tow. Alcyone orbits Sirius and the center of the Milky Way galaxy every 225 million years. And Sirius, our Milky Way galaxy, rotates around the center of the universe. Well, that would be a cosmic year, wouldn't it? Once around. We'll get to how many times we've been around. This, what you're looking at, is one of the most fantastic pieces I was able to find. This would be the galactic central sun. Is that Alcyone or Sirius? Okay, there's Earth. And you're going to find this has to be Sirius, and you're looking at a 225 million year cycle. This will be demonstrating our precession of the equinoxes and why the Earth wobbles the way it does, 23.5 degrees towards the great central sun, the center of the Milky Way galaxy, or away from it, depending on which is above or below the galactic equator. So not only do we rotate in a circle, we have an orbit which goes up and down. Then we have a pull. Now we don't have a pull. Now you'll see when it's in the center, it's straight up and down. There's no magnetics on either side. Keep this in mind. This is extremely important. Okay, so right there, our elliptical orbit crosses the center of the Milky Way equator. And as you can see, it's actually going to be going down. This is our elliptical orbit. And 25,627 years ago, when we were that direction.
Ancient scholars who observed precession of the equinox provided a simpler explanation than a wobbling Earth. They said that our sun curves through space, moving in a great orbit of its own, pulling the Earth and other planets along with it.
Search your feelings. You know it to be true. This is a correct picture of our orbits from a top-down view. But since the sun is traveling, let's turn it on sideways. Let's give it a three-dimensional. If you were to watch the orbit of our sun on a vertical motion, it's called a helical orbit. Our sun is traveling through the galaxy at an incredible 132 miles per second, or 482,000 miles an hour, which means we travel 11 million miles a day, whether you're awake or asleep. Here's Voyager 1 and 2, and looking out at our heliosphere as our sun barrels through the galaxy at a blistering 482,000 miles per hour. It's 11 million miles a day we travel. I mean, we all know we spin and we go, but in 1 year, at that velocity, awake or asleep, we travel 4,222,000,000 miles a year. That's what I call a mothership. We're already on the mothership.
We all live in a helical solar system. If this term sounds new, you're not alone. Most people don't know what it means. This video is an opportunity for you to learn that the helical solar system is where we all live. It will help you understand what a helical solar system is and show you how it moves. We live on planet Earth, one of the eight planets revolving around a star we call the Sun. The Sun is one of millions of stars in the Milky Way galaxy. During the 20th century, astronomers discovered that the Sun itself is revolving around the center of the Milky Way galaxy. The Sun's velocity as it orbits the galaxy is currently calculated at 134 miles per second, or 482,000 miles per hour, a very substantial velocity. For centuries, we have been taught that the planets of the solar system move in flat orbits in a plane called the ecliptic, with the sun at its center. All of that is still true, except for the term flat orbits. Because the sun moves, no planet can follow a flat orbit. To keep pace with the Sun, It has to move in a spiral, or a helix, as the astronomers call it. Here we can begin to see the helical paths of each of the four inner planets as the sun and planets move away from the camera. So by focusing on them, we can best demonstrate how helical orbits fit around the sun. Moving outward from the sun, we see Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars. We can also see that the planets closer to the sun have to move faster than those farther out.
I could watch that all day. So as we're hurtling through the galaxy, one might say, well, you know what? Don't we line up with our central sun, Alcyon, every precession of the equinoxes, every 25,627 years? Absolutely. In fact, twice. Once at 12 o'clock and once at 6 o'clock. But we're over on this side of the galaxy. Right here, this is 25,627 years ago, 23,000 BC. Now, fast forward as we orbit in a counterclockwise position that way, with Alcyon in tow, watch what happens when we fast forward one precession of the equinoxes, the alignment that we read about earlier, Earth with our moon, our sun, alignment with Alcyon and Sirius, all when? Anybody? Right on cue. I love that. Which means it's pretty big. The last time this happened was never. And for the life of me, I am going to apologize in advance. There's only one thing I could think of to call a triple solar alignment. Now, this is what the Mayans said, Earth, Moon, Sun, Pleiades, Alcyon, the greatest star in the Pleiades constellation. Now, by this point, probably not most, but more humans than not, have heard about 2012. Some reference that the Mayan calendar, the last day, also marks, but within 31 days of now, virtually every human being alive on planet Earth will know that that means the world will end. The sky is falling. Which, of course, is preposterous. It's the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard in my life. Not one prophecy, scripture, piece of writing ever says the end of the world. Not one. It's nowhere. Chicken Little. It certainly doesn't say it in any Mayan prophecy. It's not in the biblical prophecy, not in any Indian prophecy, not in the Quran. Never says the end of the world. I have a standing offer for anyone to show me any prophecy, any writing that says it's going to be the end of the world. Doesn't exist. This world that we live on, this third rock from the sun, is exactly that. A big, giant rock. It's not going anywhere. There's only one prophecy, to my knowledge, which even correctly uses the phrase. And yet, while no prophecy ever states the end of the world, they do all point to the end of something. You've probably heard the phrase 1,000 times. End times. End time prophecy. The Mayan prophecy clearly states the last day of the calendar marks the end of time. It's not like it's the end of the world or anything. It's only the end of time. They called it a time of no time. Whoa. Trippy. Now, until time ends, time will appear to do many things. Speeding up. How many of you here have said or have heard people say, God, I just don't have time for it. I'm just so swamped anymore. Right? Anyone who remembers vinyl records knows that back then life was on 33 and a third. We lived life there. Somehow it got bumped up to 45, 78. Now it seems like we're at 115. And life goes by Monday, Tuesday, when December already! Search your feelings. You know it to be true. I have posed this question of hundreds, if not 1,000 people. Name me a meal you ate day before yesterday. Okay, can you remember a meal you ate yesterday? Day before yesterday? Why does it seem like that could be last week already or last month? When I grew up, what I did last night was definitely last night. See, don't believe a word I'm saying. It's all in your own. It's bizarre. Now, there's a very logical explanation for this. The most popular explanation is that time isn't speeding up, but our consciousness is, which makes it seem like time is speeding up. Incorrect. That is assuming that time is the variable. You have to make sure you're starting with the correct variable and one is constant. Otherwise, it's going to appear like the opposite one is moving. Ian Lungold on the bottom here, which is probably this author's four-year-old nephew, believed that time was speeding up because creation was speeding up. In other words, more was happening in less time. Yes and no, still incorrect. Again, that implies that you and I, we are the constant and everything else is speeding up. Now, if you were to travel at light speed, were it possible, everything else would seem like it's almost at a standstill, correct? Now, for everything else to seem like it would be speeding up, we would have to be slowing down. At the point where we're slowed down to a standstill, everything else would appear to happen all at once. This is in accordance with the prophecy. 5D, the 10 dimensions, scientifically demonstrable dimensions, 6 to 10 have apparently already collapsed. 1 through 3, first through third dimension, collapsing behind us. No future, no past, squeezing us out of the fourth dimension into 5D, the fifth dimension known as heaven. Why is time speeding up? Scientists discovered many years ago that the Earth gives off a pulse, which you may know as the Schumann resonance. This pulse or frequency has been approximately 7.8 cycles for thousands of years, a constant. Global military was developed on this cycle, 7.8 cycles per second. until 1980, it started climbing this constant for thousands of years. It started climbing. It's currently measured at over 12 cycles out of a 13 possible cycles. So they go in the rainforest where there's no humans for hundreds of miles, and they stick a stethoscope up to the planet, and they feel the heartbeat of the Earth. 7.8 cycles till 1980, climbing exponentially. It's 50% greater now, which is why it seems like we have a 16-hour day. Do not underestimate the power of this next piece. This next bit of evidence should blow your mind. Which isn't a bad thing. Your mind could probably stand to be blown.
At Purdue University, actually as early as 2006, scientists have been noting changes in the decay rates of numerous nuclear particles. For those of you who don't know, that we have actually quantified a very steady and consistent and reliable data on what are known as the half-life of nuclear particle, right down to nanometers, which is a billionth of a meter and a billionth of a second scale. They've even got it down to the femto level, which is a quadrillionth of a second scale, and of course, a quadrillionth of a meter scale. So they know that this is consistent formula. You don't normally see changes in these decay rates. They're seeing changes as great as a tenth of a percent in some of these radionuclide particles, which is unheard of. In fact, there's no way to explain this as far as they can see, and it shouldn't be happening because this is one of the only known constants next to the speed of light constants that scientists are aware of. But here's where this story gets really interesting, William. When a nuclear particle's decay rate, it speeds up, it means it's radiating more, not less energy. So all of the particles in our bodies and the Earth are, due to this new change of the sun, are radiating a little bit more energy, not less, than they were before. And we know that studies done on human DNA, that very, very weak changes in electromagnetic fields can cause profound changes, for example, in fish. And they're beautiful. The changes on the fish in this particular experiment were rainbow stripes suddenly appeared on all the new offspring. But there's no doubt children, because their DNA is in a rapid growth phase, they are going to receive more of this change than we are. I'm excited about this because I want to know if it's intelligent consciousness that is doing this. And as the Purdue scientists are saying, there is a new particle possibly responsible for this being born out of the sun. And that new particle will have new properties and new and cause abilities in humans and all living things that ingest it. So if there's a new particle being created, and that's what's responsible for this, these Purdue scientists are saying, it's going to change everything.
This changes everything. Actually, the change has already occurred, and is occurring exponentially. This gives us now a verifiable new way to look at this. He says the rate of atomic decay is sped up a tenth of 1%, unheard of and inexplicable. See, as we're approaching the photon belt, we've been in the fringes of it for about 50 years. As we're about to hit it smack dab, it's exciting things. The rate of atomic decay, the Schumann resonance, new DNA. It's quite possible that it's awakening a sleeping DNA cell, changing our carbon-based life form into a crystalline life form. And it's exciting everything. It's supercharging. Remember, in this time, Kanikahau, our sun, receives a spark from his older brother in the center of the galaxy. Solar radiation is exciting not just us here on Earth, but the atmospheres of Jupiter, Saturn, Mars. They're storms. They're excited. And what you're going to notice, what we will notice here, is our atmosphere excited. Not necessarily the one you're out looking at, but your atmosphere that you carry with you. It's going to feel excited, revved up, agitated almost. Were you able to go faster than the rate of atomic decay, it would appear to be going slower. But for the rate of atomic decay to appear to be speeding up, It could be us that are slowing down in relation to it. Again, this is squeezing us out of the past, out of the future, into this moment of now, apparently where our thoughts manifest instantaneously. That's sometimes a scary thought, but we would learn how to control them a little bit better. Even scientifically, time is an illusion at best. You see, time is an invention, a creation of universe herself, to keep everything from appearing to happen all at once. Which it does. It did. Is. You know, I'm sure it's just a coincidence that everything that was foretold was going to happen is happening exactly when they said it would. I'm sure it's just an oversight. Have no fear. When do the heroes always arrive? In the nick of time, right? So now you know that time is appearing to speed up because we are slowing down. The universe has been expanding for 13 billion years and is currently showing signs of slowing her expansion. Now, this is the NASA website, which states, our solar system is currently passing through an interstellar cloud. Not about to pass through. Not maybe we're going. Is currently traveling through an interstellar cloud. It takes 2,000 years for us to traverse. Now, when asked the implications of this, Dr. Dimitriev replied, global catastrophe. Not in tens of years, but in ones. And you know what that means.
This is your pilot speaking. Please fasten your seatbelt. You may experience a little turbulence back there. We should be through it in just a few years. Thank you.
Apparently, the galactic equator is like a ring of Saturn and has this roughage in it. Now, this is fascinating. Remember this interstellar cloud? Now, I folded it in half because I know the photon belt is a ring. And watch what happens when you fold this puppy in half and look behind you. Poof, instant perpendicular photon belt. What's this going to mean to us here? As we go through this belt, which may be like the rings of Saturn, maybe some space debris in there, but what there isn't there is any magnetic pull. It's the equator. There's no plus, there's no minus. What this might look like is, in those days, the sun shall be darkened and the moon shall not give her light. Another one says, after the night of three nights, the following morning the sun will rise. Another one says, the sun shall not set for days on end. Well, which is it, dark or light? This picture will give you an excellent clue as to how both might be true. Figure it out. Depending on where you are. People say, well, this one's true or that one's true. The sun should be dark and moon should not give her light. That's dark. In Jerusalem, Israel, in about 33 BC, yeah, that would be a miracle. If he spoke these words 33 years before he was born. In 33 AD, Jesus spoke those words. Meanwhile, on the other side of the world, they say, hey, we got plenty of light over here for a long time. So when faced with an either-or question, remember, both may be true or neither. So as you can see here, this picture is very telling. There is really only one reason why it's dark on one side and light on the other for days on end. The last time we came out of the backside of the photon belt was 11,000 years of night. The last time was about 10,200 years ago, or 8600 BC. There you go. Fast forward two Mayan cycles, and we've been in the null. We've been in the outer rim of this photon belt, which we enter smack dab. It's estimated. Now, I'm going to make a statement. There's no such thing as a Mayan prophecy. There's a very precise Mayan calculation. Now, this interstellar cloud has been exciting the atmospheres of all our planets. Jupiter, Saturn, Mars, they're seeing all these storms happening. As we enter, as you can see here, this flat plane, this elliptical plane, what happens can be explained with a child's toy and a coffee grinder. We are the yellow ring. Alcyon's the silver attached to the rails, and it's rotating around the center of the Milky Way galaxy. Which our Milky Way galaxy is a flat or disk galaxy, which actually rotates on its side. But when we reach zero point, no pull either way, left or right, like a battery, a whirling dervish, pow!
Slips away, and all your money won't another minute buy. Dust in the wind, all we are is dust in the wind.
All we are is dust in the wind.
Dust in the wind.
Not only possible, but quite imminent. But remember, it's Andrea's fault. There is only one reason the sun is darkened, light and dark on opposite sides of the planet for days on end. Just like that. Because we've stopped spinning. Voila, for days on end. Won't that be a trip? In other words, to stop, we have to slow down, which is in accordance with what we just heard about the particles speeding up. The world faced with destruction by strange men from a distant planet. Yes, their hero is on a rescue mission. But the last frame of this movie is pure prophecy. Now again, for the world to stop spinning, it's got to come to a slow. It's got to slow down, which is going to make it seem like time is speeding up. If we're spinning, time is only measurable between two things, one in apparent motion to the other. If we're stopped, doesn't that clearly mark the end of... time?
So the end of time. The end of need for time-bound awareness. No, okay, so on 2012, December 25th, what if we all woke up that morning with amnesia? You see, didn't even know what is this? I don't even know what's a cell phone. I know how to use it. Who am I? Where am I? How I get here? Total amnesia. slate white clean, then what need have you of a clock? You see. So the end of time, then, I don't know. So we all wake up with amnesia. How this happened? What if December 21st, 2012? See, but not just 2012. Every 5,127 years. You have to ask, what did the Mayans know? That happens every 5,127 years that we don't. You see, it is true, because all for one and one for all, you love in yourself, you see. And you cannot love another, and first you love yourself. So love yourself. I love you. I'm Mani Narobe. And we see you in 2012. Yeshua Messiah.
Voila, prophecy fulfilled. The end of time. That leaves a couple to go. It says, not since the beginning of creation to this time, nor ever shall be. So whatever's coming is pretty, pretty special. It's happened never. The prophecy that says, after the night of three nights, the sun shall rise. Oh, there was a missing line. Shall rise in the west. I mean, we don't just stay stopped forever. Could it be that once we're stopped, we start up again in the other direction? Boy, that's going to be a ride. Now think about it. Then we'll be rotating clockwise. Our thoughts will be going in the right direction. The clock will be going in the right direction. Sun shall rise in the west. Boom. Prophecy fulfilled. Now this time speeding up, dimensions 6 through 10 collapsed already in front of us. 1 through 3 behind us, squeezing us out of the fourth dimension. Right into the fifth dimension.
This is the dawning of the age of Aquarius. Age of Aquarius.
In accordance with the prophecy. Now, Greg Braden, I don't know if you ever heard his name, supports the work on this and is traveling, showing scientific proof of the Earth passing through the photon belt and the slowing of the Earth's rotation. The Earth will be stopped, and in 2 or 3 days, it will start turning in the opposite direction. Wow! Since creation, prophecy fulfilled. Or is it? Everybody knows our poles have flipped 12 times, once for every sign in the zodiac. Have we ever reversed direction? Has the sun ever risen in the west? I have no verification. I could find no reference of the Earth ever reversing its spin before. But whatever's coming, if you follow this, which seems to plug into all the written prophecies so far, it says, such as hath not been seen since the beginning of creation, the beginning of time, to this time, nor ever shall be. So whatever it is, you are going to be here to see what no human being has ever witnessed before. Since the beginning of time, okay, we better look, if we're looking at the end of time, we better look at the beginning of time, right? The Big Bang, or actually this is the only place where science and religion overlap. Science says, in the beginning was a ball of matter the size of a pea, which instantly expanded 360 degrees. Everything's made of it. Okay. Religion says in the beginning was A word. I don't know. We don't even have words yet. Okay. In the beginning, the word was God. All things were made by it. Without it was made no thing. Everything's made of it. I shortened that down and made it easily identifiable. In the beginning was banana. And not one thing exists which is not made of banana. You see, now you know what you are. Very clear what you are. You are a chip off the top banana. This is the Hubble telescope's farthest view into space, galaxies, thousands of them. I want to touch on this sentence by science. In the beginning was a ball of matter the size of a pea. That's all that still exists if you take out the spaces between the atoms. They've also discovered, using a sophisticated algorithm, scientists have now calculated the actual size of Earth. Now, keep in mind that an atom is 99.99% repeating empty space, and the amount of matter in the nucleus of an atom is similar to a piece of popcorn in a football stadium. That's all the matter that's there, even in the hand you're looking at, but that's another lecture. So in the beginning was a ball of matter the size of a pea is preposterous. It was nowhere near that large. Which also answers the question, how many angels can fit on the head of a pin? Why, all of them, of course. The sun, how many of you heard of Planet X or Nibiru, the other side of the sun, the red-brown dwarf, which is apparently intersects with the Earth every 3,600 years, shoots iron rain at us, which burns up in our atmosphere looking like meteorites. Don't know, not my field. Apparently, Planet X, Nibiru, the return of Quetzalcoatl, can only currently be seen in the southern hemisphere, and for all my searching, I was only able to find this shot from a bedroom window in New Zealand, but if you look carefully, you should be able to catch a glimpse of it. Let's see how we're doing. We've got earthquakes, we had days of darkness, which measured also the end of time, not since beginning of time, to this time. This still leaves a question in my mind. Whatever it is, it's never happened before. So if we've already reversed directions and the sun has risen in the west, I don't know, can we check this one off yet? We had better have a look. Not since the beginning of the creation of the world, or not since the beginning of, there's several different versions of this, but it's not since everything, and not, nor shall ever be. Now, before anything was created, to a ball of matter the size of a pea, time doesn't exist, does it? Because you need two things to measure time. But when we were all one, whether it's the Big Bang, or it was God in the beginning, there was only one. No time is possible, he measured. Albert Einstein, my buddy over here, would concur when he stated the past, present, and future are occurring simultaneously, or all moments in time are occurring concurrently, at once, in one instant. Thank you, Albert. If outside the time stream all of this has already happened, the only way to predict the future is to remember it. Now, if we've already spun around in the other direction, then that's already happened. So it couldn't be that. Even though that marks the end of time, then it can't be that. Have you figured out there's only one other way to end time when you've eliminated the impossible? Whatever remains, however improbable, must be the truth. Spock, new Star Trek prequel. Sherlock Holmes. Elementary, my dear Watkins, correct on both accounts.
They're from the future.
If you eliminate the impossible, whatever remains, however improbable, must be the truth.
They're from the future.
If you eliminate the impossible, whatever remains, however improbable, must be the truth.
How poetic.
This was the beginning of time. One, expand, pow, instant universe. Well, maybe universe has been expanding for 13.7 and it's just been breathing in. Now, if you just breathed in all the time, you'd explode. Gib, Gnab. What if, when we cross the galactic equator, while Earth, Sun, and Moon are pointed straight down the barrel of the Milky Way galaxy, this is what it looks like December 21st, the view from Earth's center, but our ecliptic, let's get the equator there, and as you can see, our elliptical path goes up and down, as we saw before in the movie. On this day, when we hit 0 point, when something that has happened never before, we are all lined up straight down the barrel of the dark rift at the center of the Milky Way galaxy. Meanwhile, our solar system has wrapped up its precession of the equinoxes. Right here, December 21st, 2012, starts a brand new one, while Sirius completes her 225 million year rotation around the Milky Way galaxy. Maybe it's like a big bank lock. And after every 12 hours, it clicks. And all the locks and keys can collapse. This is the only other way time ends. Oh, relax. It's not like it's the end of the world or anything. All things are cyclical. Maybe universe lets her breath out. Did anybody just hear me say reverse Big Bang? It's possible. All things are cyclical. Universe takes a breath and then breathes again, right? And the end of one thing is always the beginning of another. So even if December 21st, 2012, people will be expecting Armageddon. Hopefully we get apocalypse, which is supposed to come at the end of the world or of time. An apocalypse actually means to uncover or reveal. It's called the lifting of the veil. This is in accordance with the prophecy, entering the photon belt, the age of enlightenment. This makes sense. So even if December 21st is the last page of Revelation in the book, that's not the end. December 22nd. 2012, you turn the book over, you open the book again, and what is on page one of the book? Genesis. New beginning. The coming into being of something. A new age, an age of enlightenment. The origin. People are so freaked out. This world's going. What if that one's the one we're here for? An origin, a creation? And God saw it was good. And the rest of the book, that's on page one. The rest of the book, he never takes that back. Poof. Prophecy fulfilled. See? We have a brand new world to work with. Earth goes through her metamorphosis. That's why we're here. We're growing. We're changing. We're going to come out the other side and be a butterfly. Noah comes, he arrives, lets all the animals out. We have a brand new Earth to take care of. Oh, there is one last one. Speaking of Noah. Okay, we had earthquakes, end of time, days of darkness. Okay, it's either the sun spins in the west. If that's good, no reverse Big Bang. If that's already happened, only thing that we don't know has ever happened is a reverse Big Bang. So, either way, since creation, prophecy fulfilled. Even if you're not biblical, we all know the story. Nobody believed Noah, right? They didn't believe him. As in the days of Noah, there shall be much eating and drinking and giving and taking in marriage. And as you know, every truth, even if Noah's saying the truth, it goes through three stages. First, it's ridiculed. Then it's violently opposed. And the third, Yeah, it's true, but we knew that. Right? So it is written, as in the days of Noah, there shall be much eating, drinking, giving and taking in marriage, wine, women, and song, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, and it shall come upon the earth as a snare. Whoa. Trippy. Which means that while we're listening to Pandora on our smartphone and checking Facebook on our iPad, meanwhile trying to figure out the next American to idolatrize, also looking up the best pet yawning video on Yahoo, we'll be so jacked into the matrix under the hypnosis that we won't even see it coming. It'll come upon the world as a snare. Just jack right into the matrix. Why not? See, this world has a consciousness, global consciousness, and this world doesn't want it to end and only gets its power from us giving it power and doesn't want it to end. So choose which world you want. Rock, paper, scissors, choose, because there will come a day in the near future where you won't even have one more day to choose. And then you can have your own checklist. Boy, that's trippy. But I said in the beginning, don't believe a word I'm saying. And Noah, nobody believed Noah. Nobody believed Nostradamus. They certainly don't believe the Mayans. Why, they didn't even believe Jesus Christ himself. So don't believe me. I'd say that puts me in pretty good company. Now, I never thought of myself as God, but what's my opinion compared to thousands of others? Now, the last piece of information. How many astrological ages do we go through? 12. In one precession of the equinoxes, which means on December 21st, 2012, we'll begin our 13th astrological age. Of course, it goes back to zero, but we would be beginning our 13th age. Sirius, 225 million year cycle, 12 cosmic years around the universe, the center of the universe. 12, 12, which means we're about to start our 13th. And check out the Mayan date on 12/21/12. 13. I want you all to take a moment and wish a very happy birthday, 13th birthday, to our mothership. We're 13. Haven't you noticed, no matter how old people say they are on their driver's license, whether they're 20, 30, 40, 50, 80, they still act like they're 5? Nobody on Earth is older than Earth consciously. We're not even teenagers. This is our bar mitzvah, our bat mitzvah, our coming of age. 33 days from today. Happy birthday! It is why you're here. And you are the heroes that are about to arrive. As a last note, using a highly sophisticated piece of computer software, I was able to keep track of all the total number of hours I invested in this project, pictures, searching the internet for news clips, highlighting, cropping the fonts, custom graphics, music, sound effects, PowerPoint, animations, video production, and editing. And if somebody guesses the right number, please email it to me. Now, can anybody just take a wild guess exactly how many hours I invested in this project? Thank you.